to talk about, starting talk about the graph model, okay? And why we will talk about the graph model? So last class we talked about XML and the hierarchical model. Do you remember? The last three classes, in fact, right? And we hit it a lot in the hierarchical model, how we query the hierarchical model, how we do things, paths, and so on and so forth. The last class we talked about XQuery and XPath, right? Okay. And so now we start to break the thing. We start to think from the hierarchy to the graph. Okay? We start to move and think why graphs. But we must think why graphs and why graphs on the web. Okay? So I got here, in fact, a presentation that I have about this issue. Some of the slides I will jump because it will be some topics that I will talk further when I will explain social web and so on and so forth. Okay? So I will start talking a bit about graph databases, but in fact, I'm interested in how to represent things on the web as graphs. Okay? Today I will not talk deeply about graph database. Okay, I will talk just how we think about graphs. Okay, how we represent things about graphs. Okay, so why graphs? Well, one thing I will talk today is I will introduce the idea of linked data, because the idea of linked data is influencing a lot how we think the web as a graph. But not just that, there are the social networks and content that I will just talk a bit and jump, because it's not the main issue today. And sharing and interconnecting and complex networks, I will also talk just a bit. So, probably you heard about linked data, right? Who can tell me what's linked data? Someone can tell me what's linked data? Celso is pointing to you. He's a good friend. Really good friend. Who can tell me what's linked data? What do you think? A lot of people talk about linked data, but most of people doesn't understand what's linked data. Right? The thing is, the term was introduced by Tim Berners-Lee, which is the creator of web, which we studied in the beginning. Okay, so what Tim Berners-Lee told, when I started to think about the web, okay, the starting idea is to create links, not to jump from one page to the other. It's not that, but to express connection among things. Okay, so I have an information here, and I want to express that there is a link, there is a connection of this information with this information. So I produce a link. But what is this link? It's not necessarily a navigation link. It's a link. Okay? And see, the interesting thing is, there is a project that, in my point of view, inspired a lot the linked data, which is the project we call DBpedia. And what happens in DBpedia is a kind of way of... So now let's... Do you remember? When I talked about the web, I talked about the influence of a guy in the beginning that told that as we may think. Do you remember that? As we may think. So he started telling, we probably think as linking things. That is this Memex. I'm now trying to remember his name. Is the... Okay. I will not try. Afterwards we'll see. But the idea is, our way of thinking is not a linear way, okay? We have a lot of information and we connect things, and we do that a lot now, right, on the web. We connect information here and there, right? Okay. So the web is highly, the web project is highly influenced by this starting concept. We think in links. Okay. So if you get Wikipedia, Wikipedia is one of the best expression of what people talked about hypertext. So hypertext is the notion that we have a lot of information interlinked, right? So we have, for example, Paris. Paris is a page of information, right? And Paris is connected with Île-de-France. Île-de-France is a region where Paris is inserted, which is inside France, right? Okay. But these links are links to navigate, right? You navigate. So if you go, if you enter in the page of Wikipedia and you come, let me do that here because it is good to see. So if you go, for example, to France here and you link, you click on it, you navigate, right? You navigate. So you go from a page to the other page. But think with me what's happening. Just think about it. Because people from Libipedia probably followed the thing I will tell you. Why when you link one in some place, you go from one page to another page. What is navigate? What means navigate? You know that in the past we talked about surfing on the web. You see this term? No? First time the first browser started. We don't have browsers at home, let's say. And I went to this conventions or presentations, and I went to a place of IBM. IBM is showing to people the web. So they have some computers there and you can navigate, right? Navigate on the web. And then you take a picture. I navigated on the web. So but what do you think, what do you do when you navigate on the web? Let's do here, for example, Wikipedia, Paris. Okay. So I don't know if everybody knows that, but on the right side of Wikipedia, there is something we call info box. I don't know if everybody observed that. Okay. Lot of people exploit the info box. And what is info box? So you may see here, okay, there are a lot of texts talking about Paris and the beautiful places you must go and so on and so forth. But if you see here, okay, it reorganized the page because the resolution, right? But because you see here, okay, there is the text. This is so there is the text, and on the right you see here this we call info box on the right. See on the right? And when you produce these info boxes, they organize information. Okay, so they put country and there is a link, right? So when you click in the link, it goes to the page of France, okay? And like Paris, France also has its own info box on the right, okay? So, which has some information, same structure, same organized. It's not a free text, just. It's a table with some organized information. But what happens When I click in a link, what happens? What is navigate? Can you imagine that? What is navigate? You may imagine that it's like the web. Consider that you have a huge brain, which is the web, right? And you access information on demand, okay? Okay? So you access information on demand. So that is all this information, and you ask us on demand. It's more or less the way you also use your brain, okay? So I go to Paris, and now I have friends, and I need to access more information about Paris. So the idea of looking and reading is a human thing, right? Because you cannot be plugged in the computer, okay? Like in Avatar, that you plug your hair in the, right? You cannot plug in your computer so you can and go to the information, right? So you must see it. And so what happens when you click on the link? You have this information here, so you transfer that to your brand. So your brand there, tell me more about that. So you follow the link and go to get more information. So now imagine you are a machine, right? What the machine does is a graph. You have here Paris. You have information. Now you need something to France. So you have this edge on a graph. So you follow it. It's the same idea, but just it's not a human being. It's a machine. So the machine tells, okay, you come here and follow this link to here. Right? And this is highly important. And people from the Wikipedia consider it exactly that. You see, these links are not just navigation links. These links are meaning. These links are semantics. They are telling me that France is the capital, or Paris is the capital of France, and France is the country inside it is Paris. So, if I get all this information and I put in a machine readable form, so machines doesn't like web pages, right? Because machines must do a kind of crawling and get all this stupid free text for humans, you know, these human beings that like read things and see beautiful pictures. But machines doesn't like that. They like graphs. Okay? So you have a node that is Paris and another node that's France. And then you have edges. Okay? So this is beautiful because machines then can go up and down and read this information freely. They will do the same thing you are doing. The same thing. But instead of crawling in the text of the page, then you follow the links on the database or on some information system. So this is the starting of the understanding of what is semantic web. Semantic web is a readable web for machines. Okay? So we are trying to allow machines to read the web and do something instead of human beings. Okay? So this is the first step. Put these things as a graph and connect linking things. So what people from Wikipedia did? They did a crawling and they extracted information from Wikipedia, got these links and start to put in a graph. Okay? And you can, by using some algorithms, you can get, for example, okay, what is Paris? Paris is a word, right? What is France? France is a word. But if I want to have a meaning, I need something stronger than a word. Okay, I need something that people can connect. I need an URI. So, this is one thing we will talk a lot. I don't know if Arad told you about... I told you the notion of what's URI. You know that, right? But I will introduce here a bit, but we'll talk a lot of this thing. This is one of the most important things on the semantic web. Things on the semantic web are not just words in the wind. No. They are anchors which you can reference in any part of the web. So, for example, Paris has an URI, has an address. Okay? Has this thing here. And this address is unique in the entire world, first thing. And second thing, I can reference it in any information system I want. So, if you remember what you studied in databases, you remember the notion of foreign key? What's the notion of foreign key in relational database? Who can tell me? What is a foreign key? Everybody is afraid of me. Oh God, what is a foreign key? So, a foreign key requires a primary key, right? So, you have a primary key in some table, right? And when you want to relate to tables, you have a field here, right? That whose value is something that is the value of the primary key here. So, a foreign key is a kind of indirect pointer, right? So, I indirectly, by defining the value of the key, I relate this guy to this guy, right? So, you may imagine that an URI could be think as a primary key of this information here, and any information system in the world can produce a foreign key to it. Just that. Forever. So, this is the sense of linking things on the web. You link everything, any information system. Everybody understood that? And everybody understood the importance of that. Because I'll show you that this is essential to the semantic web. When you talk about ontologies and these things, this is a kernel to it. So, what they did? The Bepedia with this reverse engineering thing, they produce a 4 million of things, right? So, you can see the 832,000 people, okay? And you see the amount of information, and then you may imagine there are a lot of things you can do with this information. Diseases, species, organizations, creative works, and so on and so forth. Everything organized and related in such a way that machines can read, machines can navigate, machines can relate things. You can discover information. Several languages, millions of things, and so on and so forth. Okay? And they started, you see here is the scenario in 2007. Okay? So, not so far, right? 2007 we are talking about is what? Is May. So, let's say 7 years ago, more or less, is in this size. Okay? What you are doing 7 years ago, remember? Okay, it's not so far. So here you see, and so what is this map means? This is the map of the linked data. The idea is, okay, you may imagine that the Bepedia, you see the Bepedia in the center there, they started this thing. And other sites told, okay, for example, let's see here, friend of a friend, or music brands, for example. So imagine that music brands, or Jamendo, which is from music also, they want to tell that there are several music bands and players on the Bepedia, right? So if I want to reference it, Instead of put a label, I can put the URI of the Wikipedia. So my knowledge about music and so on and so forth, which can be complementary to the Wikipedia, can link the information on the Wikipedia. A machine can go to music brands, can start there, can go to the Wikipedia, get more information, and back and forth. It can navigate and combine information as they want. Okay? And then they started to put more guys and more guys. So you may imagine here, more guys here, okay? More guys. You see what's starting to happening. 2009, 2010, 2011. This is the last map. Today is probably much more difficult to produce a map because it's too much to see something and to understand something. But you can see there. If you just do programs to start to combine informations here, you discover so many things. If you just combine this information, that's something to do in the next 20 years. Just machines to read these things, combine and produce some knowledge. Okay? And this is the... There is also the social networks, but I'll jump that now. I'll jump the thing, because I'll talk more about that when I talk about social networks. Okay? And then I'll talk about the model. Okay? Graphs, we started thinking, what is behind the linked data is a graph model. Okay? And as a graph model, we will compete with other models. One model you know, so you may imagine that you want to describe this prehistoric animal here. Okay? A plesiosaurus, right? Okay, plesiosaurus. You know what's a plesiosaurus? No? No? You know that people who know prehistoric animals, they usually get good grades in my classes, right? I'm just kidding. Okay. It's important because it's on record. Okay. But this is a prehistoric animal and I want to describe it. Okay? So there are several ways to do that. You may imagine you have a lot of description things. And you studied at school that you can do a relational database. You put everything in a table, right? And this is good. But there are limits. For example, these things are excellent to manage data with predictable and static schema. Okay? And when you start to link the things like we did in the linked data, when we start to link information, freely link them, the static schemas in some part of the problem will be something that will hamper, will create difficult to freely connect the things. And also, these guys are much more predictable. Okay? Another thing is, tables are not the best thing to share. If you think to share, you may imagine you have your database, right? Your big and beautiful database. Okay. And then I tell you, okay, can you send me the information you have about Triceratops? Okay, I have a relational database. It will be difficult to send you just that. I can send you the entire database if you wish, right? I will do a dump, if you know what is that, and I will send an entire database. Or, if you wish, I can give you access to my query language, and you do your query and you get what you want. But it's difficult to produce a pack of what you want and send to you. It's not designed to do that, right? For sharing. Then comes XML, and we talked about these things, right? XML is a kind of document. So it's hierarchical, it's beautiful, it's good to share. You put everything inside the document and you give to the people. So if you imagine that the description of my plesiosaurus is in this XML document here. Everything you need is inside this pack. Okay? It's self-contained. So it's excellent to share, to send people. Okay, send me the information about Triceratops. What will you do? You pack the records of Triceratops inside documents and send to me. Right? This is the things that people use, for example, to produce messages on web services. So web services like a lot these things. They put things they want to send to the other web services in a XML document and send it. Right? It's good to pack and deploy. Okay? So this is excellent. It seems perfect. Right? But the problem comes when you start to normalize things. So for example, this is not aligned, but here we have a Plesiosaurus and here you have a Plesiosaurus, okay? And you want to tell these two guys is the same thing, okay? Here you have a place and here you have the same place. And you want to tell that this is the same thing, okay? And here you have a country and the same country. So the problem here is I have a lot of redundant information, okay? And I want, so this is too much confused, right? Let me go to the next, and this is better to see, okay? So for example, here I have Plesiosaurus and Plesiosaurus. And I want, this is the same species. I want to tell that this is the same place, Lyme Regis. Okay? I want to tell that this is the same country, for example. This is a problem in databases we call normalization. You remember that? So is the idea is, okay, I want to have a central place where I define these things and then I relate them. Okay? And it's possible in XML. We studied that, right? We can do a href. You remember the href? You do a reference to the other guy. And we studied in the last class that we can do joins, right? The X query enable us to do a join of things, okay? So it's beautiful, but it's not so natural. Why is not so natural? This is my point of view, okay? What's not so natural? Because this is hierarchical stuff. Was designed for sharing and deployment, not to database. And when you put these things in a database, you can produce query languages and so on and so forth, but in my point of view, it's a kind of artificial way. In fact, how much hierarchical is your data? This is the question. Okay? We are using a hierarchy, but in fact, your data is not that hierarchy. Okay? The hierarchy is just a way to share it, but it's much more a graph. Things linked. And if we go back to the relational database, because you can tell me, okay, you are telling about the problem of normalization, right? And in normalization, we can solve it in relational databases, okay? Because in the relational databases, you can just produce the tables and do for eigen key, these things you studied at school, so it's okay. But then there are other kinds of relations that are not good for relational databases. For example, you have a fixed schema, but I want to have the freedom of connecting things. Okay, so for example, these two triceratops, you probably know them, right? Calicornis, Triceratops, Calicornis, Triceratops ohidus, no, okay. So, but the thing is, the second name is a new name for the first one. Okay, is they changed the nomenclature, and I want to tell in the system that the second is a change the first. Okay, how can I do that in a relational database? I need to produce another table, blah, 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 blah. It's hard, expensive, and so on and so forth. Okay. And Patricia, you solve it, right? You solve this exactly this problem. She will solve it. She will produce a graph database connected to the relational database, and everything is solved, right? But the thing is, what I want to produce here is kind of relations that are outside my schema. I want to freely relate things. And you see that graph databases is more or less in this direction. Okay? But you will pay a price. You pay for that. But we'll talk about that after. I want, for example, to tell that these two columns, one column, which is the country, includes the place, for example. So I want to produce relations inside the schema. I want to relate everything. I don't care. I want even, and we will talk about that in the future, even this distinction of schema and data, in some sense, is not so natural, okay? Because sometimes my schema will become my data. For example, I want to tell that the country comprises the place, okay? So the place is inside the country. So this is, I want to transform my schema in my data and why to tell something about it, okay? So I want to produce links. This is the thing. So there is this trade-off of static schemas. They are not that bad. They are not that evil as you think, okay? It's important to have static schemas because the poor guy that will produce the application can rely on the schema, okay? I will produce a software. It's hard if you tell me. For example, you may imagine you are in a company and you want to produce something that will store data of your employees. Okay? Okay. And then you ask the guy, okay, which data you want to store about your employees? And the guy tells you, you know, let's do something flexible. I don't want to define hard schema. But then, what kind of thing you want to produce? Like, some employees you store something and others not. You don't. So in some scenarios, in several scenarios, you want to have a static schema, a predictable thing, because you will do basic things like the payroll of your company or the finance evaluation or something, and you want a static schema. And for this reason, several entities, and we discussed that when we talked about XML, if you remember, produced their schemas for metadata. You remember that? And I told you, okay, several organizations started to produce schemas. Why? Because they want to have a standard way to do things. For example, describing living beings. This is a work that my student Eduardo developed, in which he analyzed several standards to represent the same thing, which is describing living beings. Okay, so you have animals and you want to describe them, and you have all these standards. And the problem is when they are hard schemas. If you have XML schemas, it's good to produce an application because it's easy. You know what you need, you store it, you manage it, but it's not a good idea if when you have integration issues, when you want to connect information, because then you must think how you connect the things. Okay? Okay, so I'll jump the things. These things I'll talk later. And let's go to the graphs. Let's jump to the graphs. What happens when I want to put things in graphs? Okay, so let's go to our Triceratops. Cute, right? It's a cute Triceratops. Okay. Okay. So these triceratops here, I have again my description card, and I starting to transform it in a graph. Let's think how you transform it in a graph. Okay? So I can think, for example, that each information I have is a node. Okay? For example, the ID of my triceratops is a node. So, for example, and then I have this guy here is a Triceratops horridus. You remember that? So I produce an edge connecting is a and the other information. Okay? And the size is 9. So I produce an edge, the size is 9. And so on and so forth. So, did you understand how I transform it in a graph? Everybody understood it? Okay. So this is a graph representing that information. Okay? Good. If now comes a question, okay? Now comes a question. I'm talking about how can I say? I'm talking about the I lost the connection. Not recurrencia is the when I replicate the data is the redundancy. I'm talking about redundancy. Okay. So if you want, I want to compare this solution with a table, okay, which I showed you a table. And we are talking about redundancy, okay? How do you compare them? Which one do you think is more redundant? Hello? Which one? Who can tell me? Luis, which one is more redundant? This then, if I represent that as a table, relational database, for example. More redundant, why? So I don't know if I well understood, but for example, in a table you have is a column, right? One time I will tell is a, and everybody in that column is a. I don't need to repeat this information, right? Here, each one of the records. So if you go, for example, to the Triceratops, it has again is a, again size, again recognized. So it will have again and again the same edges. You got it? Okay. I can, if I want, I can have some approaches to avoid when I store. I can try to avoid redundancy, okay? But we must think that the model is in some way redundant, okay? Just to see that it's not perfect. It has its own applications. It's not for everything, okay? And redundancy here has not just one problem, then more one problem. It's not just a storage issue, okay? There are other issues. For example, how can I say that size here is the same thing of size here? Okay? If I just use the label size, how can I say I'm talking about the same column, let's say, or the same information? Okay, so this is a thing that we will discuss. Okay, What's the advantage of using graphs? For example, it's good to freely connect things. So we, if we go to the linked data notion, okay, you may imagine that on the right side I can have some graph storing the locations in the world. For example, we have in this linked data, big linked data thing, one thing we call geo names. They have all the places in the world as nodes of a graph. And relations, like this thing I got from geo names. So in geo names, they have Lance Creek is part of Converse County, which is part of Wyoming, which is part of United States. So all this information is in the graph. And I need just do one thing. I just connect my Triceratops to Lance Creek with the origin edge. Now I already connected things. I'm using here a linked data approach. And if I do the same thing, for example, with my Tyrannosaurus, it seems a Tyrannosaurus. Not too much, right? Okay, if I do the same thing, and you want to tell me, okay, let's compare these two guys where they were found in these two places, okay? But I want to analyze their relations based on the graph. So if I go to the graph, okay, so here I have this guy here in Hell Creek, that guy there in Lance Creek, and I analyze the graphs, because these graphs, these relations are in the geo names, okay? I will find some place which is a common area, and I can infer that all these animals are in this area, okay? Are share this common area, okay? And inside the geo names, I can even get the size of the area, the climate, and everything, and so forth. And I can deduce if they share some common environment, some common conditions, and, for example, if they interacted by themselves, just looking on the graph. Are you following me, everybody? Okay. So, and this exists right now. You can do that right now. It's not something that we are planning for the future. For example, geonames is inside the linked data thing. And I have a student that already did these things. So now comes the URI. You remember the universal primary key, which you can give a foreign key in any place you are. So you may imagine that my Triceratops must reference this URI. And when it references this URI, it is connecting to the information system of geonames. It's a graph, so I can do all things I told you, going there in geonames and going up and getting the information I want. Okay? And we will study here these things. There are two ways to do this kind of inference. I can go to the patterns. So, we have query languages, which work similarly to XQuery and XPath. Similarly, okay? In the sense that you may imagine that one thing that you want to do in the graph is follow a path, right? You want to go to a path to find something. The only difference here is that this is not hierarchical as in XML. So I don't have the same hierarchical approach. I don't start from the root, for example, because there is no root. Okay? Here we work much more with patterns. Patterns inside the graph. I try to find something that fits the pattern that I want. For example, I can tell, find a species, and you may imagine here a species like a kind of node, whose origin, which can be a relation, right? And one, zero or more levels are part of United States. Okay? So, what this means? This means that I want to find something. You may imagine that this guy here is a species. Okay? And origin is this relation here. Right? And I'm telling that in zero or more part of is inside the United States. So this is a pattern. And we have, I show you this query in a language, in a query language. You can just produce a query. And the system goes there and try to find something that matches that and tells you. Okay? One thing is, when you use this thing, you may know in advance the pattern you are looking for. You must know how to find the thing you want. Okay? Another way to do the same thing is the inference. And how do you do an inference? It's different because you just tell to the system, please find a species whose origin is United States. But you don't tell the system how to do the path of part of, for example. But then I have in the system rules that tell me that if A has origin B and B is part of C, A has origin C. I do a kind of inference here. And then if A is part of B and B is part of C, A is part of C. So this is transitive, right? And I can produce these rules and store these rules. And then when I ask, find the species whose origin is the United States, the system trigger the rules and infers that the guy here, you infer that Lance Creek is inside the United States applying the rules. So you tell you, okay, the Triceratops answers your query. And I will show you now that these are the two most important or competing approaches to do things on graphs, on the web. Okay? So I will jump this thing, okay? Okay.
And if you have all your first part of the angles, is origin point to the length space. Even then, you have more references than related to the space. But you have just one load of the space.
Yeah, but in the relational database, if you normalize it, it's the same. You have just one record of Lance Creek, which is in one table, right? So you may imagine that it's the same. If you normalize, not necessarily is different because the relation will become a Foreign key. So a Foreign key will spend more or less the same thing off the edge. So if you are talking about relations between tables, probably is not fair. But if we are talking about data that stay inside, like the properties there, then here comes redundancy. Because, for example, size 9 will be a column of the table without even foreign key and nothing. You don't understand? I jump this thing to talk later about topology and this thing also. And I go straight to tell you the models, okay? So when you want to store things as graphs, now we have competing models. In the semantic web, and we study that deeply, we have the RDF graph model. And the RDF graph model is something like, I will just talk a bit, further I will go deep in this issue, okay? But we have a resource, a property, and a value. So a resource will be an edge of the graph. And we have a property, and we have one value. But the value can be another edge of the graph, which can also have a property. So, for example, I have two ways, okay? One way is the value of the property is an edge, but is a final edge. So, is a square. We call literal. For example, the number 9 is a literal and is a final edge. There is no edge coming out from this guy. So, it's a square. It's not necessary, but usually people from RDF community use a square to represent it, okay? But sometimes your value is a node that can be described further. So you have another oval there, so your value becomes a resource, so you have another property and another value. One thing in RDF, so let's consider here. Consider your resource is the thing you are describing is this plesiosaurus, okay? Okay. And then you want to tell that the size of the plesiosaurus is 5. So you have something we call triple. What the triple tells me that resource is the first guy. Okay? So is the record, the number of the record of plesiosaurus, right? Second thing is property, which is size. And third guy is value, which is 5. So, resource, property, value is everything in RDF. Everything. Okay? You don't need nothing more than that. Okay, so, for example, now if you want to tell, it was recognized in this year, you produce another triple, resource. The same guy. Property, recognize it. Value, this year. Okay, so you produce this guy. And you go and go and go. For example, you want to tell that this guy is a Plesiosaurus dolendoneidaeros. This guy here. Okay, so you again, resource. Property, value. And in this case, you see, it's not a literal. It's another thing that I can reference. So then, you go further and you can create, you see, resource, property, value. But then, the value becomes a resource, property, value. And you produce everything. But, one important thing here. Very, very important. Everything is an edge of the graph. An edge or a vertex on an edge. And that's it. So, for example, if you want to tell, okay, this guy here, the name Plesiosaurus is in Portuguese, okay? So you can tell, okay, this guy is a resource and there is a label Plesiosaurus and in Portuguese is Plesiosaur, for example. And you go further. Okay? I will not enter in all details, but what you need to know that is everything is resource, property, value, and nodes. There are a competing model. And this competing model we call property graph. There are in fact two competing models, but this is the second one which is important to me, which is property graph. Property graph, we have node. We have properties of the node. So you see, in RDF, we don't have properties of the node. We don't have it. If you want to do the same thing in RDF, You must produce edges and other nodes. Edges and nodes, edges and nodes. Okay? You have properties and values as part of the node. And then you have edges. So you have the node, you have properties inside the node, and you have edges. And you have properties of the edge. So let's get the same plesiosaurus, the same guy, which is happy to be again here. Okay? So now I want to tell the size and the year it was recognized. I don't need to put it in a graph. I can just produce properties and give values. Okay? But I will produce nodes of other things. For example, the origin is in a place. In this case, it's much better to produce a node because other edges will point to it also. Okay? So it's a node and we produce an edge and so on and so forth. So in this model, we must decide what is property, what's edge. Okay? We must decide it. So you may see that we can put labels and things, and we can put things even in the edge. I can tell that the origin of this guy is in this place and it was discovered in this year, and put the property as something of the origin. You see? So I will show you that these two competing models, for example, the property graph, is highly used, for example, in a well-known graph database we call Neo4j. So Neo4j uses this kind of thing, okay? And the REF graph is well known from the semantic web, okay? And there are also databases like Virtuoso that stores and query data on the RDF graph. Okay. What is the advantages and the disadvantages? Property graphs is in some cases are less prolix. Okay. When you put everything in the graph, you can have a kind of explosion of edges and nodes. Okay. And so in this case here, we have a more compact representation of the things, okay, than the other. And in some cases, we can store the data in more compact way, okay? On the other hand, I will show you that the RDF, it's designed to be as simple as possible. Because it's like a base or a machine language to build everything on top of it. Okay. So in the next classes we will evolve to the idea of going toward the graphs, get things in the graph, and also how we think the web, the semantic web, as a web model. As a graph model. Why graphs were selected should be the basis of the semantic web. Okay. I will show you that we will change the model from a hierarchy of XML to a graph from RDF. Okay. Questions? Okay. Go ahead. Yes.
How can I connect another origin that was discovered on 1824?
Okay, so your question is if I want to connect all animals of this in the same year, right? Oky. So the guys of the graph database, you answer your question in two ways. One thing they will tell you, okay, if it's just a year, as you told, years has no usually has one way to write a year, right? If it's a date, can be different, but a year is just a year, right? So the thing you want to do I can do the same query, just getting all the edges whose property discovery is the same number. So it's easy. But your question could bring us to something more complex, like a name or something that can have ambiguities, right? And then the answer to your question is, this is the price you pay when you put things like properties. Because the price you pay is, you don't explicitly put things linked. You don't explicitly link things. So you must be careful when you choose the things that becomes property. Because the things that become property are easier to do things on them, as easier, are more compact, but you pay a price. You not connect the things. Okay? For this reason, RDF is pure connection. Okay? They pay the price and tell you, okay, I will pay the price. Put everything as nodes and connections. And go ahead. And this is the idea. It's more expensive in some sense, but could be more interesting for the semantic point of view. Okay? More questions? Okay? So, thank you very much, and I will see you on Thursday. Right?